What's going on, everybody? Welcome into episode 53 of the Two Stripes Podcast, the podcast that covers everything happening in the world of college football. My name is Colton Denning, and I'm your host, coming to you on the first day of summer, June 21st, 2018, with a new episode of the show. It's been about a month and a half since I've done one, so glad to be back on the wagon and want to thank you for tuning in. Of course, if you're looking to follow along with the show, you can subscribe on Apple Podcasts. Just search the Two Stripes Podcast. It's on SoundCloud, soundcloud.com/twostripespod. You can follow me on Twitter, at Dubsco, for any updates about the show and just my general musings about college football and everything else going on. And on YouTube, go to youtube.com/ColtonDenning. You can find all of the episodes there. With all that out of the way, let's get into today's show and our preview for this episode, and that's the Tennessee Volunteers. Terry Lambert is today's guest. Terry is the lead writer slash head honcho over at RockyTopTalk.com, SB Nation's Tennessee blog. He joined the show last season to preview what ended up being Butch Jones's last year in Knoxville, so it was good to talk to Terry again and get the scoop on what is going down at UT and new head coach Jeremy Pruitt. That was a lot of this episode was talking about what Pruitt brings to the table, how the program is headed in a different direction philosophically, both in terms of culture, the way he coaches, and X's and O's on both the offensive and defensive side of the ball. It's a big departure from what Butch Jones did. So that was interesting to hear the evolution and the ongoing process that is that change under Jeremy Pruitt. And I think Terry dropped a lot of really good nuggets in this episode about Jeremy Pruitt's plan and how Tennessee is attacking not only 2018, but 2019, 2020, and beyond with building this program and getting it up to a place where they're competing for SEC East titles every year, which is something that they haven't done for a very long time. With all that said, that seems like a good portion of this intro to transition into the interview and get to talking to Terry and get his thoughts on Tennessee football. So here he is, Terry Lambert of RockyTopTalk.com. I am super excited to be joined on the Two Stripes podcast by a returning guest for the second time to talk Tennessee football, and that is Terry Lambert, who is the site manager and lead writer for RockyTopTalk.com. Terry, welcome back to the show, my friend.
Thanks for having me on, Colton.
So we talked almost this time last year. It was, I think it was June 30th. The title for that episode was 2017 is a make or break year for Butch Jones at Tennessee. And well, things broke a little bit. Without getting too much into Butch Jones and a lot of what happened last season, if you just look back at 2017, what do you think that that year is going to be remembered for amongst Tennessee fans?
An inability to replace Josh Dobbs, really. I think that's what it all comes back down to. Quentin Dormady was not really a Butch Jones fit, even though he committed to Butch Jones. He was a pocket passer and not a very good one. So Tennessee saw a lot of talent walk out the door after the 2016 season. Instead of reloading, the bottom fell out. You know, injuries piled up. And, it was just I think it showed us kind of who Butch Jones was and how much Josh Dobbs and sort of that 2016 group really carried him.
One of the things we talked about on that show was the Florida game and whether or not that would be another heart attack game and whether it would define the season. And I think on the checklist of that, it crossed off both of them. And looking back at that game and the Hail Mary and the way that ended, that kind of defined what the season was going to be for them.
Yeah, it was just another gut punch. That Tennessee showed some fight in that game. Yeah, there were some positives to take away there. But once again, the Hail Mary, Tennessee found more ways to lose under Butch Jones than they found ways to win. So looking back, I don't know if that game saves his job. It probably doesn't the way things kind of fell apart, and I don't know if a win would have meant more confidence down the stretch for that team, but it was two bad teams, as it turns out, and Tennessee ended up getting heartbroken by the Hail Mary. So if Butch Jones brought anything to Tennessee, At least he broke that long, decade-long streak of losing to Florida.
So the big thing that everybody talked about with Tennessee this offseason was, of course, the coaching search. It went on for 26 days, well-publicized with, you know, reportedly hiring Greg Schiano, and Tennessee ends up with Jeremy Pruitt. How did people feel about that whole situation, and what has, or what was the reaction when Pruitt was hired?
I think everyone loved Pruitt from day one. I think after, you know, you look at the arc of the search, you go from Schiano, you go from Mike Gundy in talks, and then you go to Dave Doran at NC State, then you go to Jeff Brohm, you go to Mike Leach, and you ended up getting an SEC guy through and through in Jeremy Pruitt, even if he came from Alabama. And all through that, Philip Fulmer takes over the as AD, and really has been a stabilizing force. So I think there was a lot of trust placed in Philip Fulmer to kind of right the ship there. And then people really took to Pruitt. You know, he's just a down-home country boy. A really good fit in Knoxville, considering what Butch Jones was and his catchphrases and all that. Jeremy Pruitt is just a no-nonsense guy, and fans seem to love him already.
No-nonsense was actually the word I had written down in my notes about his personality. And going from the eras of Butch Jones and even back to the 1 year of Lane Kiffin and Derek Dooley, it seems like Jeremy Pruitt has a much different personality. You hear it in some of the stuff he says, what he said after the spring game, which was very infamous. And it does seem like that personality and sort of no-nonsense is something that Tennessee really hasn't had in a while.
Yeah, he's the polar opposite of the last three coaches they've had. You know, you look back to Lane Kiffin, he was all flash, you know, he was kind of the sexy hire and a young guy. And then you go to Derek Dooley, who loved talking to the media and just going off on wild tangents and telling stories and cutting up with the media. But you just got the sense that he wasn't all about football. And then you go to Butch Jones, who was just only interested in his catchphrases. And now you get to Jeremy Pruitt, and he's just like, get me out of here. He doesn't even want to talk to the media. So he's 100% about football. He's just wanting to do things to get his football team better. And if he's not doing those things at that very moment, he's not very happy.
How was that background he's had with not only working under Nick Saban two different times at Alabama, but also Jimbo Fisher at Florida State in the 2013 national championship team there, kind of translated to what he's brought so far in Knoxville in terms of early player development, recruiting strategy, and just, I guess, the overall culture of what he wants his program at Tennessee to be?
Well, I think you're seeing it, and obviously he hasn't played a game yet or coached a game yet. I think you're seeing it on the recruiting trail. The guy is a rock star on the recruiting trail. You look at all these recruits, and they just talk about how he's going to get them back. There's a sense of confidence around Jeremy Pruitt. That's something that Tennessee really hasn't had since the days of Philip Fulmer. So it's really hard to say right now. You know, you had the spring game. The big takeaway there was Pruitt calling out some players that quit, calling out fans. You know, there were 65,000 fans in the stands, and that wasn't good enough for him. So I think he's kind of Nick Saban-ish. With the media, in that he's just going to say what's on his mind. He doesn't really care. But again, SEC guy, he knows what's going on in the South. That's relating really well to this fan base so far.
Something interesting about his strategy, and you know, I may be wrong here, but they're bringing in 9 transfers, 5 JUCO kids, and 4 grad transfers. And I would assume that Pruitt and his staff know that they probably aren't going to be competing for the SEC East title this season, that this is going to be, you know, a thing that takes a couple of years to really get off the ground. But it seems like that background under Saban, he's like, no, screw that. Like, we know we may not be there this year, but we're going for it. And whether that's bringing in a guy like Keller Christ, the grad transfer quarterback from Stanford, Madre London, the running back from Michigan State, and a couple of other guys, it seems like they're making moves that would normally be seen as short-term fixes, but they're also doing that with, like you said, what his recruiting strategy is. So it's really interesting from my point of view of kind of how he's attacked this job so far, and it's not something I think you see a lot with coaches coming in.
It can't be overstated how bad this roster is. I mean, 4-8. that was Tennessee's first ever 4-win season in the modern era. This roster really bad. There was a lot of holes. So I kind of look at those grad transfers as Band-Aids. You can't go out there and recruit like Jeremy Pruitt is recruiting. He's already landed a 5-star. He's got a top 20 class. You can't go out there and go 4-8 again. So I think he's desperately trying to put a good product on the field. I think he's desperately trying to make a bowl. I think a 6-6 season would be a huge success. You know, Tennessee fans just want to see signs. If the wins don't come, I think it's going to be okay. But if you see a competitive football team that gets better, through the year, all of Butch Jones's teams got worse as the year drug on. If this team gets better and the arrows pointed up at the end of the season, it's going to be a success. And a lot of those guys are immediate starters that are going to come in, so they're going to help.
So getting into what he was brought in for, and his background was, of course, defense. And a lot of that being secondary and as a defensive coordinator, how do you think what he likes to do defensively matches up with what Tennessee's personnel is right now?
Not very well. It's interesting. The roster is set up for a 4-3, so he's changing over to a 3-4 base. Obviously means getting lighter on the edges, and Tennessee just doesn't have those linebacker pass rushers right now. So he's working hard to get those guys in, but he's not going to have all the answers in year one. So going back to the spring game, the offense kicked the defense's tail. And that's not something I expected to say, because Tennessee ranked 124th in total offense last year. So the offense is well ahead of the defense. So I'm not sure he's going to be able to put out all the scheme things he wants to do in year one, simply because this roster just isn't ready. You look at the pass rushers, Tennessee doesn't have a pass rusher. They're not going to be able to get pressure with a four-man rush. They're going to have to get creative. They're going to have to scheme things up. They're going to have to blitz. So I'm really shaky about this defense. But we'll see what kind of strides they can make in the season.
It was a defense, too, that was really bad when it came to efficiency-based statistics. They were 115th overall in defensive success rate. They were 126th. In points per trip inside the 40, they stopped big plays, but it didn't really matter when teams were just able to get 4 or 5 yards on every single first or second down and be in third and shorts the whole game. But there's some players coming back for this defense. Linebacker Daniel Batuli and safety Nigel Warrior are the two guys that stand out most to me. What do they each bring to the table, and who are some of the other guys to keep an eye for on the defense?
Well, Nigel Warrior came along at the end of last season. He didn't start until middle of the year, but man, he came on. He is an athletic force, playmaker. He had a pick six against Missouri. So it's kind of hard to evaluate him because that defensive group was so bad. But I think he's a guy that can do a little bit of everything. He can get out in coverage. He can come up and hit you. So really excited about him becoming a leader. And Batuli really burst on the scene against Georgia Tech in that wild opener against that flex bone option set. Had something like 20 tackles. It was crazy. But he's a guy that's really flown to the ball. Really athletic. He had a pick six against Alabama. So there's some budding talent there. I don't think the whole picture is there by any means, but there are some players there. And then you've got Darren Kirkland Jr., the linebacker coming back. He's probably going to start alongside Batuli. Experienced guy that's been riddled by injuries, but when he plays, he's always seems to be around the football. So at the linebacker spot, Tennessee's actually really strong there. Where the problem lies is in that defensive front, those front three, front four, and then secondary. You've got a bunch of new corners. You lost 4 contributors at cornerback. So cornerback is the main issue for this team, in my opinion, and it'll probably make or break the defense.
Earlier on, you talked about that move to the 3-4, and coming from Alabama, Pruitt had a stable of guys that he could go from, sometimes 9, 10 deep at Alabama. And just looking at Tennessee's depth chart, at least when it comes to recruiting rankings, there's a lot of former blue chip talent that he's going to be able to work with on that defensive line. Guys like Shai Tuttle and Jonathan Kongbo are two players that are heading into their senior seasons. And at least in Tuttle's case, hasn't really matched up to what that ranking said he was as a player. How do you feel about the defensive line? And do you think that that's an area where it may be, you know, a little shaky right now? You don't know what you're going to get, but given Pruitt's history, that if not this season, then in 2019 and beyond, that's going to be the rock of Tennessee's defense?
I think it's shaky. I think they're undersized. You've got Kyle Phillips is probably their best player, but even he's undersized. You know, you look at Alabama, they've got 6'5", 300 pounders, you know, 1, 2, 3 right there. So Tennessee does not have that, but they are recruiting that, and they've already got a couple of commitments for next year. That's why I say I'm not sure it's going to work this year. It certainly did not work in the spring game. Tennessee lined up first-team offense against the first-team defense and ran right through them. So that's very concerning considering where Tennessee's offensive line is at right now. Shai Tuttle is going to have to step up. He's been hurt. And it's kind of been the thing that Butch Jones left is a lack of player development. And Shai Tuttle's the poster boy for that. Even going back to Khalil McKenzie, who declared early, you know, Jonathan Kongbo's in that mix. Just a slew of defensive linemen have underperformed at Tennessee. So maybe with some new coaching, maybe that can start to change. But still, those guys are seniors now. They're going to have to play out of their minds to even make Tennessee respectable on defense.
Speaking of the offense, they're also undergoing a change from what Butch Jones liked to do to new offensive coordinator Tyson Helton, who's more of a downhill running and then hit him over the top with play action and the deep ball. How does UT's current offensive personnel fit into what he likes to do?
I actually am cautiously optimistic about this offense. I think they've got some playmakers on the perimeter. Juwan Jennings is back after being kicked off. He's back. Marquez Callaway, who exploded in that Georgia Tech game, didn't really hear from him the rest of the year, though. Those are two legitimate NFL receivers, in my opinion. Their production is going to be tied to their quarterback. So I think they've got a good stable of backs. You know, you've got Ty Chandler returning, who flashed against Kentucky, more of a home run hitter. And then you've got Madre London, who you touched on, incoming transfer from Michigan State, is going to have one more year. So you've got a bigger back. You've got Ty Chandler there. I think the personnel matches up really well. Again, though, it's a matter of how well this offensive line can gel, and it's a matter of whether Keller Crist or Jared Garantano, whoever wins the quarterback job, how well they can play. You know, the quarterback's always the linchpin of the offense.
What's been the offensive line's biggest issue? Because just looking at them and at the two deep, they have guys that I'm familiar with from recruiting in Drew Richmond and Trey Smith that you would seem like, hey, this should be a pretty good offensive line. But from what you're saying, it doesn't seem like they've been able to put it all together, and that this season that's going to be a key factor of how good they are, especially in a conference that has so many talented defensive lines.
It's been odd. For 2 years now, Tennessee has just been bitten with injuries. They played against, I believe it was Southern Miss, with 6 scholarship offensive linemen.
Can't do that.
No. And then they did, I think they played against LSU with 7. So, and that's happened for 2 years in a row. I don't know what the deal was with Butch Jones and his training staff, but clearly something was wrong there. I mean, that's a little more than a coincidence to me. But those injuries have just kind of stunted some growth, stunted some development. They've got talent. Talent's there if they can stay healthy. So, like you said, Trey Smith is probably going to be an All-American. He might be the best guard in the country already. He stepped in from day one and was just destroying people. So that's one piece of the puzzle, though. You know, you need 5 to really do things in the SEC. You got Brandon Kennedy, the center coming in from Alabama, which if you pay attention to the college football world, I'm sure you heard about him. The SEC changed their rules to where you can now play immediately and transfer within the conference as a graduate. So Tennessee took advantage of that, and they've got their starter in the center, Brandon Kennedy. So that's 2 really solid players right there. What's going to be around them is kind of up in the air. You know, you mentioned Drew Richmond. He's a former five-star recruit. He just hasn't developed. He's been kind of bad from day one, and he stayed there. So, again, you just hope this new coaching, Will Friend on the offensive line, you hope they can coach him up and start to develop some of these guys.
That's funny, right? As we're talking about this, Tennessee Football just tweeted out, join us in officially welcoming Madre London and Brandon Kennedy to Rocky Top. So
there you go.
Guys are officially on board in Knoxville. And let's get into the QB battle. Earlier, we talked about Keller Crist and his battle with Jarrett Guarantano. How is that going so far, and how do you see that shaking out?
Well, Garantano's got the jump on him, working all through spring. He's got about a month head start getting into the playbook. Keller Crist arrived, I believe, 2 weeks ago. So we'll see how that plays out. But Garantano looked like he took some major steps forward from last year. And again, it's unfair to judge Garantano from last year. It was his first game action. Like I said, playing behind that banged-up offensive line, didn't have much time. It was constantly under duress. You know, you go back to that Alabama game, and Alabama's just teeing off on him. You felt bad for the guy. So it's really hard to get a gauge on where he was last year. But at least in the spring, he looked like more of a confident passer. He looked like he saw what was going on in front of him. He knew what to do with the football. So that was encouraging. And then you got Keller Crist, a guy who's done it before, who's played in a similar offense at Stanford, 19 career touchdown passes to just 6 picks. He takes care of the football. Completion percentage is down. The Stanford offense seemed to struggle with him at times, so that's a little concerning. But you look at his experience, and that's something that is probably going to win his job if I had to call it today.
Either one of those guys is going to have weapons, as you mentioned, Juwan Jennings, Marquez Callaway. If they have solid quarterback play, it seems like they can be really dangerous receivers. And then the running backs with London and Ty Chandler, who showed a lot of really good flashes last season, are capable SEC backs as well. What do you think the bread and butter of this offense is going to be?
I think they're going to run the football. Tyson Helton said that when he was introduced. He said it again at a Tennessee pep meeting. He said they're going to run the football to win. There's going to be a time where everyone knows you're going to run the football, and you got to be able to run it anyway. So that's encouraging to hear. I like that. I think that's the way to win in any form of football. And I think they really value bigger backs. I think Ty Chandler was kind of slated for that featured role. Now I'm not so sure. I think it's going to be more of a platoon. So I think they're going to use Madre London a lot, 6'1", 218 pounds. I think they're going to want to grind things out, playing some lower scoring games. I think that's going to be their bread and butter. And then I think they're going to utilize play action and go over the top with those athletes on the outside.
I liked what you said earlier about Butch Jones' teams tending to start the season strong and then fade as the season goes on, because this team in Jeremy Pruitt's first year looks like it may be a little bit different, if only because of the schedule. Not only do they start with West Virginia in Charlotte to begin the season, but also before November, in the span of a month, Tennessee plays Florida, at Georgia, at Auburn, and then Alabama. And so it looks like, from an outsider's view, that they're going to struggle a lot at that first portion of the season, but it's going to be hard to really identify how Pruitt's doing until the end of the year, when the schedule gets a little bit lighter and you may see them really turn it on by the end of the season. They're going to be 3-4 months into playing together to understanding the system. And if they get through that slate of games in October relatively healthy and with a good idea of what they want to do offensively, it seems like that's kind of the portion where you're like, okay, I see what Jeremy Pruitt's doing here.
Yeah, you really just kind of want them to be competitive in that 4-game stretch. I don't think any Tennessee fan has any expectations. Maybe they expect a bowl. But I just, for me personally, I want to see them go out and win the games they're supposed to. I want to see them go beat Vanderbilt, which is been
that's something we talked about last year.
It's been a problem at Tennessee, and that should never be a problem at Tennessee, just considering how that high of a level that Tennessee usually recruits at. So go beat Vandy. Go beat Kentucky. Maybe you go steal one against what should be a pretty good South Carolina team. Go beat Missouri. You know, go look competitive against West Virginia, and if you can win that one, great. So I think it's more about perspective, because I think those losses are going to come. They're gonna rack up. Again, if you can get to 6-6, look competitive, not really get blown out too bad, I think Tennessee fans are going to be plenty happy with that.
I think that South Carolina game on October 27th on the road is like low-key the game of the season for them, where if they win that, then it's going to be a real possibility to see them get to a bowl game and, you know, get to 6 wins, 7 wins, maybe.
I agree, because, you know, you're done with that big stretch. You know, you've kind of taken your lumps. You're, what, 2 months into the season there. You should kind of be – we should know who Tennessee is at that point. If they can hang in with South Carolina, I'll feel pretty good about it.
All right, final question here. What do you think progress is for Tennessee in 2018?
Like I said, a bowl game appearance would be spectacular, considering where this roster was, you know, just 8 months ago. You know, showing signs of life on offense is going to be big. You know, seeing how this defense comes along, even if you don't have the right pieces in place right now, it's going to tell us a lot about how good of a coach Jeremy Pruitt is and this rock star staff that's around him. So, like I said, it's not necessarily wins or losses. I just want to go see him compete. I want to see him come close. I want to see him look like they belong on the same field as Florida, Georgia, Alabama, and those types.
Yeah, very interesting times for Tennessee, especially in a new-look SEC East where Florida hires Dan Mullen. Georgia's obviously doing what they're doing, and then you add in to what's going on in the SEC West and the powers with Alabama and Auburn and others. But if you want to keep up with everything happening in Tennessee football, make sure to visit RockyTopTalk.com. Also, give them a follow on Twitter at RockyTopTalk. And follow Terry on Twitter. You can do so by going to at TLambertFB. And if you're an NFL fan, he's got you covered there too. He's a contributor over at MusicCityMiracles.com and a host of the Locked On Titans podcast. You do it all, my friend. You're all about Tennessee football. You got it on lock.
I do. I'm a busy man.
Make sure to visit Terry there and also go to RockyTopTalk.com. Terry, I am thrilled to have chatted with you once again about the Tennessee Volunteers. I hope that this year goes a little bit better than 2017, and we'll chat later on down the road and see how this first year Jeremy Pruitt went.
Sounds good. Maybe our chat next year will be a little more optimistic.
I hope so, man. Thank you for joining the show.
Thanks, man.
Shout out to Terry for joining the show once again. Always great talking Tennessee football with him, and in a new SEC East that has Georgia, who looks like they're going to be a national power for years to come under Kirby Smart, and Dan Mullen taking a lot of headlines with his first year at Florida. Tennessee's probably going to be under the radar a little bit this season, unless something extremely wild happens. But Pruitt's going to get to work behind the scenes a little bit, I think, and build his program up. And there's going to be a lot less attention, I think, right away than there was under Butch Jones. So interested to see what happens in year one for them. But I think this is a multi-year project that Pruitt is undergoing, and he's certainly saying the right things as of right now. He has a pretty defined culture, like Terry said, and what he wants to do. It's just a matter of whether he can implement it. And that's just going to be something that I think remains to be seen. Also of note that I wanted to talk about here in the outro as we wrap up the podcast, and Terry mentioned briefly the saying that you don't know what you have until it's gone, I think directly applies to Josh Dobbs in Tennessee, as Terry mentioned. Like, he was a guy, as his career went on and people saw that he wasn't necessarily a superstar, I think we all sort of said, oh, this guy's overrated. He really doesn't do that much. Tennessee will be fine once he moves on. And boy, that was not the case. Josh Dobbs was a very talented college quarterback, and I certainly look at his tenure a little bit differently in hindsight than I did while he was there, given what happened to Tennessee last year and how a lot of their struggles offensively just came back to not having Dobbs, and Dobbs being a guy that could just do everything for him no matter the situation. He was always there, and once he wasn't, things kind of fell apart. So just something interesting to note as I wrap up the podcast here. Before I get out though, if you were a first time listener, on this episode. I hope you enjoyed the show. And if you did, please be sure to subscribe and leave a review on Apple Podcasts. Search the Two Stripes Podcast. You can find this episode, all the other previews that I've done, and the future previews I'm going to do leading up to the 2018 season. The show is also on SoundCloud at soundcloud.com/twostripespod, and it's on YouTube on my page. You just go to youtube.com/Colton Denning. You can find this episode of the show, all the old episodes, the future episodes, all the Ohio State videos I cut. If you're into Ohio State football, there's Maurice Claret, Santonio Holmes, Michael Jenkins, a lot of past Buckeyes, and guys that are on the team right now, J.K. Dobbins, Dwayne Haskins, and a lot of skill position guys. So if you're interested in Ohio State football, I've got a lot of videos up there on that YouTube channel as well. So be sure to check it out. That's it for today's episode. I want to thank you once more for listening to the show. And until next time, my name is Colton Denning, and this is the Two Stripes Podcast.